people are losing their jobs just before the election, so they're not going to say that. But yes, they're seeing it for sure. And you know, obviously, but we mustn't forget that the inflation numbers are probably tweaked as well to make them seem a lot lower. I mean, it depends how you measure inflation, but the way I look at it, we've got the level of government debt rising by 7 or 8% a year at the moment. You know, that's 7 or 8% more wealth on the planet, if you like. So how could the inflation rate be only 2%? Well, they're not measuring everything. I mean, if you ask the average Joe about his grocery bill or the price of fuel or what it costs to go on holiday, they won't tell you that it's gone down. They'll tell you it's going up by more than 2%.
On this episode of the What the Finance podcast, I have the pleasure of welcoming back Clive Thompson. Doesn't need much of an introduction, has been on the podcast 3 times now, but he has years of experience in the wealth management industry and a really unique insight, I guess, into central banks, monetary policy, and what's happening around the world. So, Clive, thanks so much for coming back on the podcast.
Well, thank you very much, Anthony. I think you do me too many favors by saying that I know what's going on. Yes, I've been working in wealth management for 47 years and I've been retired for 3, so that makes 50, I suppose. I'm doing a lot of financial research in my retirement, but I still can't see the future. I only can make a good guess at what's going to happen and help people, other people do the same thing. But let's have a chat about that. What do you want to talk about, Anthony?
Yeah, definitely. We've got a lot of places we could take it. And I think it's better to, I guess... know your capabilities and rather than the people who are just very arrogant and how they predict things and what's happening in the world. But yeah, I'd love to start very broad. And I guess, what is your current outlook on what we're seeing in the economy? There's lots of things happening, you know, US election, federal rate cuts, all these other factors. What are you currently seeing? And yeah, I'll leave it there.
Okay, well, I think if we look at the US economy, we have a slowdown going on, despite the official numbers. They recently raised the GDP numbers for the last quarter, but the real number, I think, relates to the employment numbers. People should not be believing the non-farm payroll numbers as an indicator of how many people are employed. There are significantly less people employed in the USA today than there were a year ago. There are significantly more people unemployed, and those figures are there for all to see if you look at the household report from the Bureau of Labor Statistics, which explains, if you burrow down, where those super numbers from the non-farm payroll are coming from. And I can tell you in simple terms, the numbers are looking very good when you look at non-farm payrolls because of, firstly, the huge number of government workers they've employed in the last year, which have goosed those numbers significantly. Secondly, they're including in those numbers the number of jobs. But if you look at the number of people, if you look at the other statistic, which is the number of people working, and of those number of people who are working part-time, there's been a very significant amount, percentage, who have gone down from full-time employment to part-time employment. So when you look at the numbers, dock off the government workers, make a small reduction for the people who've gone to part-time, you'll find that the unemployment numbers have gone up a lot, and the employment numbers have, the people who are working full-time have gone down literally a lot. I've got the numbers here. If I just going to bring it up if I can. So according to the government's own statistics, we have, as of September, and this is their table A1, according to the government's own statistics, we have 487,000 more jobs. That's unemployed people. 487,000 more unemployed people than we had a year ago. We have an additional 850,000 people who've dropped out of the labor force. And we've got 850,000. And we've got another 1.3 million who've become disillusioned. They're looking for work, but not classified as unemployed. And I'll just bring up, just bear with me for a second while I bring up another statistic here. As of September this year, if I look at the non-farm payroll, not the farm, the Bureau of Labor Statistics household report, we had 123,000 people less working full-time than we did 1 year ago. But the number of government jobs year over year has gone up by 437,000. So we've got 500,000 extra jobs in the government, yet including the government jobs, we've got 123,000 people less working. So that to me tells me the economy is slowing. I think that's the first thing. The second thing, of course, is the interest rates that are now being reduced. We've had a reduction of 0.5% in the federal funds rate, and we are expected to get another one, quarter point before the end of the year. And the market is expecting more interest rate cuts as the year moves on, next year moves on. That normally is very good for asset prices. So on the interest rate front alone, I think we can be positive on the asset prices in general. But of course, the reason they're reducing interest rates is the official inflation number has come down very close to their 2% target. And the official non-farm payrolls reports are showing fantastic numbers month after month, even though everybody knows that as we go into the next month, they'll reduce the current figure, as they always do. Almost every single month, they reduce the current figure, the previous month's figure, to make the current figure look that much bigger. So we know that the figures which are announced month after month are always revised downwards, making those numbers a lot less. But don't forget, non-farm payrolls report is counting the number of jobs, not the number of people who are working. So the fact that the number of people working is falling and the number of jobs is going up tells us that the few remaining people who are working are now having to work two or three jobs to pay the bills.
Okay, so if we're looking at, do you think that's what the Fed's sort of seeing and why they're looking to cut interest rates? Because they're seeing this sort of employee, this workforce weakness coming through the economy?
They're definitely seeing it. They won't say it outright. I mean, it wouldn't be a good thing to be saying lots of people are losing their jobs just before the election. So they're not going to say that. But yes, they're seeing it for sure. And, obviously, but we mustn't forget that the inflation numbers are probably tweaked as well to make them seem a lot lower. I mean, it depends how you measure inflation, but the way I look at it, we've got the level of government debt rising by 7 or 8% a year at the moment. That's 7 or 8% more wealth on the planet, if you like. So how could the inflation rate be only 2%? Well, they're not measuring everything. I mean, if you ask the average Joe about his grocery bill or the price of fuel or what it costs to go on holiday, they won't tell you that it's gone down. They'll tell you it's going up by more than 2%. I'll give you one small example. I just had an email from Google telling me that my Google subscription is going up by something like 50% year on year, which they blame on inflation. Well, that's my YouTube subscription. So, it's, I think wherever you look, prices are going up. The real sign about what's going on here is what's happening in the gold and silver markets. We've seen the gold price rising steadily for months and months and months. Every time it takes a little dip, people say, it's time for a pause. And then buyers turn up and drive it higher. So it's making new all-time high month after month after month. And I don't think it's the public at large who are buying gold yet. Apart from the last couple of months, we've been seeing over the last 2 years net outflows from the gold ETFs. So they're selling gold, the public. So someone else is buying. And I think what's going on is central bank buying. Central banks currently have been buying more gold than they've ever bought before this year. And that, I think, is going on. I think they've got to a point where they have worries about the level of the level of the US government debt, and they're saying we need an alternative. So they're putting gold into the portfolio instead of treasury bills or treasury bonds. And of course, silver has, I don't know how many of your listeners are watching silver, but that's had a it's broken out from its trading range in the last few days. The top end was $32.50, and it just broke out. It's trading well above $33 as I speak. And I think that's heading to a much higher level.
Yeah, and when you say sort of the governments are the ones buying the gold, that seems to be not the Western governments. It seems to be sort of more the, I guess, the BRICS and other countries who are dipping into the market.
That's true. China's taken a pause in the last few months, but the net buying is continuing, and I think that will carry on. I mean, there's just a general unease that nobody is addressing the level of government debt in the USA. There's no plan to cut there's no plan to cut the deficit. The Bureau of Labor Statistics has forecast that the debt is set to grow at a much faster pace over the coming decade than the level of GDP. So the economy is growing at a certain pace, but the level of government debt is growing faster. The reason for that is there's no current plan to rein in the spending, and there's no current plan to increase the taxes, at least not enough to stop that deficit from rising. And of course, the other thing which is helping the yearly deficit rise, that's where spending exceeds income, is the interest on the national debt. The interest on the national debt is rising rapidly due to the fact we have a lot of debt which was taken on by the government over the last decade when interest rates were close to zero. And those interest rates are now much higher than zero. Effectively, they were talking about 4-5% at the moment. So as that debt, where they borrowed money at 1 or 2 or 2.5% matures, they have to refresh that debt at the new higher rates. And that's causing another problem for the deficit spending. It's contributing to the overall increase in the deficit. And there doesn't seem to be any particular way out for this, not in the near term. So the only solution is to keep borrowing more and more to pay off the old debt and to pay the current deficit of deficit and spending. But where does it end? I think we're drawing to a close soon.
Yeah, but then I guess we are seeing this sort of cuts coming through, interest rate cuts coming through, so that might put less pressure on I guess the interest rate payments, as well as it seems like it's going to put less pressure on the banks as well, who have had lots of unrealized gains, and now that interest rates come down, it's potentially going to benefit them.
So I don't think these interest rate cuts are going to help the government, despite the Federal Reserve reducing the short-term interest rate, the Fed funds rate, by 0.5%. As we stand today, the interest rate on 10-year treasuries is 0.5% higher than that day when he reduced the rates. So at the one end, we've got the short-term rate coming down. At the longer end, and it doesn't matter whether you look at the 5-year, 10-year, 20-year or 30-year treasury bond, the interest rates are 0.5% higher. And I paraphrase here, it's a bit more than 0.5% on 10 years, and a bit less on 5 years. And obviously on the 30-year, it's worse. So that means that to the extent the government borrows money longer term, and they have been borrowing very, very short term recently, but to the extent they borrow longer term, like 10 years or 30 years, which is fairly common for governments, it's costing them now more than it was costing them when they reduced the interest rates a month ago. It also means that mortgages, the interest rate on mortgages, won't be falling anymore, as was the case a few months ago. It means mortgage rates in the USA will be rising. Another cost for the consumer, of course.
And that's a risk if there's sort of this divide between the official Fed funds rate and the actual market yields. If they start to lose control of the yield, that's going to be really concerning.
Yeah, I mean, I think what's happening here is that people are saying, well, as they're reducing the short-term rate, that actually is inflationary. So if it's inflationary, people are looking out and saying, well, with inflation coming down the line in 2 or 3 or 4 years' time, I need to be compensated more to hold a 10-year bond than I need to be compensated to hold a 3-month treasury bill. And so that, I think that explains the bond market is usually right. And the bond market sees that inflation is going to come back. And that's why the bond prices, long-term bond 10 years, are falling, and why the interest rates on 10-year bonds is rising. So I think inflation will come back. And that also, as I said, explains to some extent why people are starting to move into inflation hedges, which include, of course, the precious metals.
Yeah, but I guess it was the sort of yield curve was quite inverted for quite a long time. So now it's just uninverting. But then yep, the way it's doing it, rather than the front end going down, the middle part of it sort of coming up in the long end.
Yeah, it's both front end going down and back end going up. I mean, obviously that's more of a normality. The question is, how far will that go? And now, I think there must be a cutoff point at some point where the government says too much, enough is enough. I guess that's somewhere between 5 and 5.5% on the 10-year. When that happens, I'm expecting the Federal Reserve to become the buyer of last resort. At the moment, the government is kind of starving the market of longer-term paper because they're borrowing at the short end. So pension funds and so on who like to buy long-dated maturities are not being fed, which is keeping the rates artificially low. I think rates should be a little bit higher, maybe at least 1% higher than they are at the long end now. So there's a shortage of paper coming out from the Treasury at the moment because the government is choosing to borrow at the short end. But at some point, it's got to go back to normality. It can't keep all its borrowings right at the short end. That would be very unwise. So I think as they start to borrow at the long end, it will push up the longer rates because the public will at some point get indigestion and be unwilling to buy more Treasuries. And at that point, I think that's where the government and the Federal Reserve helps the government, steps in to buy those Treasuries from the government. But where does the Federal Reserve get the money to buy Treasuries? It doesn't have it. So we all know what happens. It prints the money. That's what happened in the global financial crisis. It's what happened in the COVID pandemic. And it's what's going to happen probably late next year, if not the year after. But they will come in as the government needs to fund its deficit spending. It can't borrow from the public because the public's got enough. At least they won't want to buy any more bonds at 5% or even perhaps 5.5% where it gets to. And they want a higher rate than that. And the government's not prepared to pay that. So they'll say to the Federal Reserve, do your job, buy our bonds. I mean, I know it's not the Federal Reserve's job, then they're supposed to be independent. But the reality is that's what they're going to do. They're going to be buying government bonds with newly printed money, which means the Federal Reserve's balance sheet will expand just as it expanded over time. I don't know if I can share a little table here. So what we're looking at here, if you can see it, there's a chart here which says, where is the gold price going?
Mm-hmm.
The main thing to look at is the sum of the Fed's balance sheet plus the US government debt. Those are both our liabilities, effectively. Since 1971, the total of those two has risen from $376 billion to today's level of $34 trillion. That's 100 times as much over the 50-odd years. You can put it another way. There's 100 times as much money in America, or American money out there, than there was. You see, when the American government borrows money and gets poorer, everybody else gets richer because it spends that money. So we've seen a massive increase in the quantity of money and government debt over the last 50 years. But the biggest increase has come since 2008, when the total of those two numbers has gone from $6 trillion to nearly $35 trillion today. I did a little experiment with this table that you're looking at to say, what if the government covered its liabilities, that's the total of the government's debt and the Federal Reserve's balance sheet, by the gold it owns. So I took the total of the two liabilities and divided by the number of ounces they own. And I can see that over the most of the period, 1971, we get to a theoretical price of gold of 57. It was, in fact, 41. In 89, we get to a theoretical price of around 500. It was around 400. In 2008, we get a theoretical price of 952. It was around 900. So all those prices were very similar to the theoretical price of gold, where it should be if the government is covering its liabilities to the tune of around 4%. But we get to today where those liabilities have increased much, much faster than in all of history. And we see that we have, if a government is covering its liabilities to the tune of 4%, we have a theoretical price of $5,321 for gold, compared with the current price today of around $2,736. So my point here is that one of the reasons we're seeing this rally in the gold price over the last year is it started to play catch up. People are starting to get an unease that this level of government debt is now out of control, and they want to hold something more tangible, something more long lasting, because we are edging slowly and surely towards some sort of reset. I don't know what form it will take, but in a reset, as a general rule, those who hold the cash or the bonds don't get paid or don't get paid in full. Whereas if you own an ounce of gold or a house or some shares in a large company, they'll still be there. And I think people are moving, those who are in the know are starting to move some of their assets into these tangible assets. And I think gold is the one thing which is the real proof of this, because gold is not affected by the fortunes of the economy. It's not like an IBM or Microsoft or Nvidia, where the profits might go up and down and change the share price. You can justify the change in share price on the grounds of how well the company's doing. In the case of gold, it has no earnings, it has no dividend, it is just a lump of metal. The desire to own that lump of metal is rising rapidly, so much so that gold is one of the best performing assets, probably the best performing asset this year.
Hey everyone, sorry for interrupting. I just wanted to extend a massive thank you to you for listening and tuning in and for your support over these 3 years. So we've had, hundreds of guests that we've welcomed on the podcast. We've had millions of views with hundreds of thousands of different people listening in. So I just wanted to thank you. You know, I started this as a student. I'm now currently working and I've always done this on the side just because I have a passion for it and I've enjoyed it. And probably similar to yourself, you listen to all these, different YouTube channels and podcasts of people listening to different guests. That's how I started. And I just wanted to sort of take the plunge and be able to have the opportunity to speak to these people. And you've made that happen. So thank you very much. Just myself, don't make any money from this. And it's really a passion project. So thanks for supporting that passion of mine. If you wanted to support the channel, all I ask is if you could like, subscribe, or even comment, positive or negative feedback. I'm always willing to take constructive criticism. I'd really appreciate that. But otherwise, thanks so much. If you can believe it, only 14% of our listeners actually subscribe to the podcast. So yeah, if you can, great. If not, no problem at all. Thanks for listening. And yep, let's get back to the show.
Do you think the rise is linked to this debt, or do you think it's linked to countries and I guess other people looking to diversify themselves from safer assets away from bonds, specifically as they have vastly underperformed, especially long dated bonds have vastly underperformed over the last few years?
I think it's all of that. There's the nervousness about whether they'll get paid if they hold government bonds, and I'm not talking about a default. The US government is not going to default, but you're not going to get paid in cash, which could buy the same amount 10 years from now as it could buy today, that's for sure. So you'll get paid in either a devalued currency or potentially a worthless currency or potentially a restricted currency. What's a restricted currency? It's a currency which you can't use in the way you want to use it. There are analogies like that. I mean, if I give you an example, in the UK, during and after the World War, they had what's called Russian coupons. You could be a multimillionaire, but if you want to buy a pound of butter, you had to have a Russian coupon to go with it. So what's the real currency here? Is it the £1 million you got in the bank, or is it what you're allowed to spend, the Russian coupon? That's just an example of the way it might go. But the reality is this: if you hold a lot of cash, money market funds, deposits, or bonds of any description, they're not going to buy you what they can buy you today, a decade from now. So I think there's a general tendency for people to move away from that asset class towards other things. And that's why the stock market's doing so well. It's why Bitcoin's done so well. It's why gold and silver are doing so well. It's even why the property market, ignoring commercial real estate, is doing so well. People are trying to move into other things to protect themselves against the devaluation of the currency. And I think that with the level of debt, of the government debt rising faster and faster, I think that trend will continue. And I think the gold price is signaling there's a general malaise about the ability to get repaid in something worthwhile down the line. So people are moving into, I think it's the foreign central banks, but to a little extent, people are starting to put gold into the portfolios. I mean, when I retired 3 years ago, the official asset allocation of most banks for gold was zero. I've seen a number of very large institutions come out and say gold has moved from an unwatched asset class to their, what they call their most preferred asset class. So I think that's driving the gold price upwards as more and more institutions start to put it into their asset allocation.
Yeah, and they're vastly underinvested over the past, really since 2008. I think there was this big boom up until 2008. After that, it sort of went down. And since then, they haven't, you know, institutions, even sort of funds, et cetera, haven't invested in precious metals really over that period.
I mean, look at it like this. If you own an ounce of gold, 10 years out from now, 100 years from now, it will still be an ounce of gold and it will still buy what an ounce of gold buys today. You own a treasury bond. Do you know what that will buy in 10 years? Well, we don't know, but I know it's going to buy less. And probably with the rate things, speed things are going, probably a lot less. And I think that's the general feeling. And of course, central banks around the world are reducing their whole exposure to the US dollar. It's currently at globally, it's currently at 57%, which is the lowest level in 25 years. So that trend could continue. We've got the BRICS summit I think it's Kazan, starting tomorrow. I think it's where today, actually. Goes on for 3 days. There are certainly rumors that they might be talking about a new currency called the unit, which might be backed 40% by gold. We don't know if that'll happen, but the discussion will certainly revolve around ways to do trade without being forced to use the dollar for everything. Because, of course, the dollar has now become weaponized, and it doesn't matter what country you are. You never know when that weaponization may restrict the way you can trade. And therefore, these BRICS countries and all their friends will be looking for alternatives to the US dollars. Now, it will take a long time to set up an alternative to the Swiss system, but it'll certainly be a topic of discussion. I don't see any major news coming out of this, but rather more a sense of direction that we want to be able to trade between ourselves in our own currencies, and then possibly to assure ourselves that one country isn't devaluing its currency faster than the other to get a competitive advantage. We want to ensure that the countries which are doing this have a certain amount of gold backing for their currency. Hence, that's why the BRICS are buying gold anyway. And possibly we want the ability to not only exchange currencies, but the ability to exchange in a currency with some gold backing. So we'll see which way that goes. It'll obviously take some time, but the direction of travel, I think, is away from the dollar and towards gold.
And you mentioned silver, that you think it's going to, you know, it's broken out of a, pretty sure it's a trend that's, or it's broken highs over the last 10 years or something. So what do you see happening there?
So we had an amazing day on Friday. Silver for a long time has been stuck in a trading range and really not going very much higher. 3250 was the resistance point. And on Friday, it crashed. After Europe had closed, it crashed to the 3250 level. It was trading at 33, in the high 33s. So it's well above that resistance point, and it was about nearly 7% higher on the day, with most of that gain coming in the evening after Europe had closed. So first of all, for the very short term, that must be giving those who are short, and that this will be the big boys, the big bullion banks who've gone short silver, it'll be giving them some they'll be in discussions about internally as to how they have to reduce their positions, because nobody wants to be at the wrong end of things. I don't think they're going to get rid of their short positions, but they'll certainly take them down a bit now that silver's moving higher. But I think the other thing to note is that the deficit between mined production of silver and industrial use is destined to get larger year by year. For the first time in more than a decade, the consumption of silver exceeded the mined supply. That was in 2022. So the mined supply, as of today and as of 2022, was less than it was a decade before that. The industrial consumption of silver had gone up and was more than it was a decade ago. The consumption of silver for industrial use, particularly electronics, is rising rapidly. Electronics are consuming around 20% more silver every year. So that silver deficit, which started in 2022, got much larger in 2023, is forecast to get much larger than that in 2024, is going to continue becoming larger. And that means that the silver price could go from here a very long way. We mustn't forget that we saw back in the 1980s a price of around $50 an ounce for silver. That was when the Hunt brothers tried to corner the silver market. They were trying to buy up all the silver they could lay their hands on. Unfortunately for them, the government changed the rules on them, or rather the exchanges changed the rules on them to protect the shorts, i.e. the bullion banks. They basically said, from now on, you're allowed to sell your contracts, but you can't buy. So as their contracts reached maturity, they were literally forced to sell. They were prohibited from taking delivery of the silver that they bought. So that took the price of fit, which was then 50, down to about the sort of $10 to $15 range, where it's remained for a very long time. Recently, we've been in the $20 to $30 range. But finally, we've broken out of that trading range. And I think it looks to me like the combination of investor demand and the industrial demand will send that price a lot higher than it is today. That's my opinion. Obviously, I don't want to say that anyone should have used this as investment advice, because I preach diversification, and I've always said that a little bit of gold and silver in your portfolio is good, but then it's a little bit of everything, not a lot of any one thing.
Yep, it's really interesting to see what's happening there. So, Clive, thanks so much for your time today. I really appreciate it. We've touched on so many parts of what's happening in the economy and, monetary policy and money in general. But my last question is, what is one message you'd like people to take away from our conversation?
Usually after these videos, I get quite a few questions coming to me via LinkedIn. I'm more than happy to answer specific questions from your viewers, whether it be should I pay my mortgage off, or is it a good idea to move to Switzerland? Those sort of things. I get a lot of questions. So anyone who has a question, feel free to write to me at LinkedIn, via LinkedIn. I'm Clive Thompson. I'll happily answer your questions. I don't have anything to sell. I don't charge anybody. I do it because I enjoy it, and I like to share the knowledge and information I've gained over the last 50 years with everybody else who can benefit from it.
Great message. And as you said, everyone can find you on LinkedIn. So that's the best place. But Clive, thanks again for your time.
Thanks, Anthony. Bye-bye now.
Hey, everyone. Thank you for listening. I really appreciate the support. If you've got value out of this, I'd really appreciate it if you could like, subscribe, or comment, good or bad feedback. I'm always open to that. But it really helps with the channel. As I said before, only about 14% of people actually subscribe to this channel. So if you were to that, it would really help. It could mean we could continue to grow. If not, thanks for watching, and see you on the next show. And you also might like this video right here. All right, thanks again.